Please welcome Chief Technology Officer for Amazon.com, Dr. Werner Vogels.
Vegas, baby. How are you guys doing? Okay, good. Hey, I heard this story last night that you should not put 3,000 AI specialists in a casino. You're not welcome anymore. I think we have had a great few days already. I have some amazing stories that I've seen there. I think some of the favorites for me were definitely the Walt Disney team with their Imagineering, really being able to dream about what you want to achieve and then go after it. I think yesterday Kate Darling's story about human interaction with robots was really mind-blowing, really opened up my eyes about the relationship we have between inanimate objects and ourselves. And so there were so many great stories told, and I think the expo has some really mind-blowing things as well. So for today, the team has asked me to talk a bit about some of the technologies that underpin all the things that we've been doing at Amazon in terms of machine learning. Now, you have to realize that machine learning is something that we've been doing at Amazon for the past 25 years. Many of the things that you see at Amazon as a consumer, yeah, whether it's recommendations or similarities, or the way that we do fraud protection or counterfeit good detection, or abusive review management, all of these things are machine learning driven. And then all the things that we do at the back end. And all of these things are not necessarily systems that you notice, you just use them. Of course, the big innovations that Jeff Wilkins showed yesterday, whether it's Amazon Go stores or the drones, of course, or Alexa, all of them have been major innovations that are really visible as sort of the AI side of Amazon. But there's so many smaller things under the covers that we've been doing for the past 25 years that I really like to believe that Amazon is one of the companies that is truly pioneering the way that we apply machine learning to real-life problems. So I'm very fortunate that today we have a number of spotlights again, amazing talks. And after that, our CEO and founder, Jeff Bezos, will come and talk to you about his vision for AI within Amazon. So if you look at the past days, you probably have seen this logo on stage a number of times. Now, this is the Amazon Web Services. Amazon has been the pioneer also in cloud computing. 10 years ago, in 2006, we launched our first services. Most important was that we've built these technologies for ourselves. And many of the things that you have seen coming back in terms of technologies that we delivered to you are first have been built for Amazon.com itself. If I look at sort of the history of Amazon, is that we really start thinking about how to build platforms that allow others to be successful. And I like to believe that AWS is absolutely one of those examples that have driven so much innovation around the world that you won't believe that. If you look at what our household names today, whether that is Airbnb or Uber or Dropbox or whatever, any of those companies, if you would talk to them, they will tell you that without cloud computing and AWS, they would never have been able to come into existence. And so we've driven enormous innovation around the world. It started off in 2006 with building our first storage service. So Amazon S3, which is a highly scalable internet-enabled storage service, really rocked the whole world in 2006 when we launched it. Nobody had thought about that before, how to actually support companies that want to reach internet scale with really solid, highly scalable, secure technologies. So in the fall of that year, we launched the EC2, our compute service, and soon after that, our database services, RDS. And underneath that sits highly scalable, secure networking and security services. Because just like with Amazon.com, AWS considers the protection of their customers their number one priority. And so You'll see also in the talk today coming back that we actually integrate security into all that we do, including, for example, all the machine learning services that we're delivering. Now, this was what was called in 2006, or maybe even up to a few years later, infrastructure as a service. But we've gone way past that, because it's not just those high-scale internet companies that started to make use of AWS, also the largest enterprises came on board, because it was way too good a deal for them as well. And so now, was it 12 years later, 13 years later, we have 165 services for you. And so it doesn't matter what kind of development you want to do, whether you want to do mobile development or IoT or analytics or, you know, remote desktops, all of these services have been built on top of AWS. And so this broad and deep set of services really drives innovation. In the past, software vendors would basically give you everything in the kitchen sink and would tell you how to develop your software. But if you do that, you basically have the technologies from 5 or 10 years ago. What we wanted to build for you is a toolkit where you can actually pick exactly those tools that you want to use, including many of the tools that underpin Mars. Yeah, machine learning, automation, robotics, and space. I'll dive more into machine learning into a bit, but in automation, we provide you a whole set of IoT services that help you manage your devices and allow you to communicate securely and safely between the devices and the services that you run in the cloud, including quite a bit of support for running machine learning models. I think in many of the IoT cases, you always have to consider that you might not always be connected. And so IoT Greengrass, which is a particular version of the IoT services, allow you, for example, to push models onto the devices and then execute the models locally instead of in the cloud. So you do your training in the cloud and then move your models onto the devices. In terms of robotics, we have RoboMaker, which is a service that allows you to build highly scalable robotic systems. And so if you go, for example, out in the expo hall, there is a company called Robotic Care Systems that has built LIA. And LIA is this internet of this AI-enabled walker that helps people that have disabilities to continue to be active. And it's an amazing system. It also runs ROS, the robotic operating system. And RoboMaker extends ROS with all sorts of capabilities for machine learning and cloud capabilities. And then there is space. If you heard Jeff Wilke yesterday talking about sort of launching a large number of satellites to provide low-cost internet services across the world, or if you saw the JPL presentation yesterday with these very new satellites that they're pushing around the world, it turns out that one of the biggest stumbling blocks for doing satellites is actually the cost of building ground stations. So we build a service for you called AWS Ground Station that has ground stations around the world, and that actually drives the cost down for those who have satellites by 80%. Because now only you have to pay for antenna time and no longer have to build out a whole series of ground stations. So we provide support for all of the pieces of Mars. But of course, most importantly, there's machine learning. Especially because we've been doing this for 25 years, we by now really understand what are the capabilities that we need to deliver to really support building, innovating into modern smart applications driven by data. And I think there's sort of four different drivers for the machine learning capabilities. At first, there is the broad and deep set of capabilities. And then you also have, of course, the ability to really drive new innovation with these services that we are delivering for you. And if you look at machine learning at this moment already on AWS, companies of every possible size are really making use of machine learning already. We literally have tens of thousands of customers on our platform that are already making use of machine learning to drive the innovation that they're doing. And so, and whether that is companies in like Change Healthcare or for example, Too Simple, which is a young business that is focused on truck communications and autonomous trucks, all the way over to companies like Bristol-Myers Squibb that are making use of machine learning to enhance the safety of the drugs that they're producing. So companies of every possible size. And they have significant impact. You know, I think, for example, healthcare is radically changing already. 10 years ago, it was impossible for hospitals to keep, for example, the data of MRI scans and CAT scans around because the cost was just prohibitive in terms of storage. And so they would archive all that data on film instead of keeping the digital data around. But now with cloud, the capabilities of all these hospitals have changed dramatically. They can keep all the digital data around. And for example, GE provides a whole series of services to these hospitals now to actually truly enhance the processing of this digital data. And if you talk to radiologists, they will tell you that AI and machine learning really is helping them to much earlier detect diseases and actually really augment their capabilities as radiologists and really change the way that the whole path of the patient through the system is working. And now the ability to actually get many more data sets together, combine not only sort of the film that you had of the MRI scan, but actually have the digital data, combine that with your laboratory data, and all these systems, all this data coming together really changed the way that healthcare is working. Capital One, great example, one of the largest banks here in the US, very well known, of course, for all their credit cards. But of course, a very important part of these credit cards is fraud protection for their customers. And so they have, of course, a long history in tracking fraud and all that data they can use to build models to really give real-time protection for their customers with respect to credit card transactions. If we think about sort of what is driving this, what are the real tailwinds that we're seeing for machine learning at the moment, yeah, there's this broad and deep set of capabilities, but it's also not actually really taking machine learning out of the hands of data scientists into the hands of every developer. And we're really focusing on democratizing machine learning so that everyone can start building smart applications. I think a third tailwind is that we now have capabilities to actually label data in a way that makes the quality of the data much higher. Because after all, remember, garbage in is garbage out. And if you really are able to actually improve the quality of your input data, you get much higher quality output as well. And the fourth tailwind, I think, is that of really being able to learn machine learning. You know, 10 years ago, machine learning really was the domain of data scientists. And today, I think, machine learning is quickly becoming the domain of every engineer. Now, if you take a bit of a deeper look at any of these capabilities, I think, first of all, we really saw that 165 different services really allow you to have broad and deep capabilities. When we were thinking about how to best support our customers with machine learning, we realized that we needed to build a complete new stack. Mostly because that democratization is really important to us. The things that we saw at Amazon.com was that data scientists are really great in tinkering with algorithms and really creating new algorithms. But there are so many more applications for which you do not need to do the tinkering, where you really can focus on just picking the right algorithm and then executing your training. So we have three layers in our stack. First of all, the support for data scientists, then the support for what I would call smart data engineers, and then also the support for AI services for application developers. Because there's many scenarios for which you do not need to have to build a new model. You just can use a pre-built model. And so for give support for each and every one of those has driven this new stack that we've been building. So let's take a bit of a look in deeper into any of these stacks. I think one of the things that has really driven the change in machine learning in the past 4 or 5 years has been on one hand, the rise of new types of hardware, such as the P3 instances in AWS, and in lockstep with that, the changes into the frameworks. Yeah, whether it is MXNet or PyTorch or TensorFlow. By the way, 85% of the TensorFlow executions in the world on cloud are happening on AWS. So this bottom layer is really the domain of data scientists. Almost what I would think as the sort of the assembly language of machine learning. Really important, really very important for building new algorithms. But it doesn't really execute, sort of really brings it in the hands of every developer. And we'll take a look in a bit what we do that for every developer. This is still very important, because there's quite a few companies and businesses around the world that still operate at this level by building absolutely new algorithms. If you look at Pinterest, for example, Pinterest has a very interesting system. It's called PinSage, which is a neural network that they've built for recommendations. So basically what they do, they take each image, whether it has a chair or a flower or shoes in it, and put it at a point in an embedding space, and then take a theme, yeah, whether it's furniture or gardening or outfits, and then use that visual content to give recommendations to their customers. It's probably one of the largest deployments of a convolutional network in the world. It is all built on top of this lowest layer of the Amazon ML stack. Now, if I really want to get machine learning in the hands of everyone, then we need to actually make some changes in this lowest layer. Because there is so much heavy lifting going on. If I look at sort of what the typical path is that everyone needs to go through, you know, you need to label your data, you need to pick your algorithms, you need to execute, then the training. And in some sense, training is pretty brute force. You know, basically, set a level, set of parameters, and you execute it over and over again until you get the accuracy that you like. Then you have a model. Then you have to execute the model. That means you have to run compute instances in multiple data centers because you need to have highly available, you need to have APIs or batch interfaces. And so all of this is so much heavy lifting that has nothing to do with the machine learning that you want to do. And so at AWS, we've always focused on sort of removing the heavy lifting that goes with any IT operation. And so we've also done this for machine learning. And I think this is one of the biggest contributions we've done to the machine learning world by building something called SageMaker. SageMaker basically shields you of all the heavy lifting that you have to do for machine learning. Yeah, it allows you to just simply have a few Juniper notebooks, fill in what you want to achieve, you pick the algorithm that you want to use, click one button to start the training after you set the parameters, you go off, have some coffee, you come back, you look at the accuracy that it has achieved, and if you're happy with that, one click of a button allows you to deploy that model. And you don't need to worry about where to run it, how to create APIs for it. All of that is done for you by SageMaker itself. It is really important because what we've seen within Amazon is that the moment that we started delivering machine learning as a service, like SageMaker, there was an explosion of the use of machine learning. Because now suddenly, every developer is becoming a machine learning developer. And so the goal really with SageMaker is to make sure that machine learning is accessible for everyone to use. And already we've got quite a few customers that are building their systems using SageMaker. For example, if you look at Intuit, Intuit is, of course, a very interesting company that has a lot of data around from many of their customers and actually really wants to start making new products based on machine learning. And so they built, for example, this product called Expense Finder that goes through a whole year of financial data of a company to find deductible business expenses. And they make use of machine learning to deploy that. And if you look at how they used to do this, and in building a system like that had many different groups involved. It's not just the data scientists, it's also software engineers, it's operations people, it's security people. All of those meant that when they were building this, originally, it would take them 6 months to deliver a new model. With SageMaker, all of this has been reduced to just 1 week. And so if you actually are able to accelerate it like that, you see a lot of innovation happening. We see this with quite a few of our customers. And this is not just happening at the NFL. Yeah, it's happening at every other sport as well. Yeah, and whether that is for Formula One, or whether it's NASCAR, or for example, AGT that built systems to enhance the UFC experience. They have sensors in the gloves of the boxers, so you know exactly with what force the other combatant was hit. Or very young companies like Huddle. Huddle tries to give this experience using machine learning to every amateur team in the world, meaning that there's thousands of hours of high-definition television being uploaded every hour done by people on the sidelines with their cell phones, and then machine learning goes off and gives advice to the coaches to improve gameplay. It's really brilliant. And SageMaker allows this kind of innovation to happen really fast. In all of this, of course, the quality of your data is increasingly important. And it's hard. You know, if you look at some of the autonomous vehicle systems, for example, they really produce this data, not just 5 times a second, 100 times a second. And to be able to really distinguish what are humans, what are the traffic lights, you basically need to have humans looking at these imaging and then labeling the data. But with so much data being generated, basically you need thousands of humans, if not tens of thousands, to be able to label the data for you. That's not scalable. And by the way, that only brings it in the hands of the largest companies that can afford that. So when we're thinking about democratizing machine learning, you need to democratize the labeling as well. So we built a system called SageMaker Ground Truth that allows you to very efficiently start labeling data. Basically, you take a subset of the data, a representative set, you have humans label it, you put it back into there, and then make use of machine learning to start labeling the rest of the data. So basically, you use machine learning to enable machine learning. It's very effective because this allows you at much faster, at much lower cost, to be able to get high quality data, which is crucial to the success of machine learning. Very importantly is that there's also a whole set of applications for which developers don't want to build a new model. They're just happy with models that there are. And as such, the third layer in the stack is that of pre-built models that everyone can use and integrate into their applications right now. And so whether that is in the area of vision, like object detection with recognition, or celebrity detection in videos, all the way over to making use of speech services, language processing, or building chatbots with Lex. Lex is natural language automatic speech recognition and natural language understanding to really build new type of applications. And also, recommendations and forecasting. It's really based on 20 years of Amazon experience to give recommendations in your hands. But you don't need to build new recommendation models. We do that for you. Yeah, and so if you think about recommendations, we've been using that for the past 20 years. I mean, there's almost no system today that doesn't have some form of recommendations. If you talk to the folks at Netflix, they will tell you that 75% of their video watching is driven by recommendations. Basically, people go sit in front of the TV and ask Netflix, what should I be watching? Your recommendations better be pretty good then. And so to make sure that everyone can start making use of recommendations, we built Amazon Personalize for you. This is really under the covers a completely managed automated service that does build recommendations for you. Basically, you give it your activity stream, whether it's a click stream or application data, combine that with inventory. Now, that can be products, of course, but it can also be articles or music. And then, if you want to, you can add some demographics to it. And then, under the covers, we create a model for you that really gives you a private, customized personalization engine. Under the covers, there's a lot of work happening there. Yeah, all these different steps are executed for you. These are all steps that you would have to do if you want to build your own personalization engine. But with Amazon Personalize, this is all done automatically for you. And there's no reason why any company should not make use of recommendations and personalization right now. So with all of that, we've created a set of services that target data scientists, that really democratize machine learning by putting it in the hands of every engineer. And then those that actually just want to build applications that are smarter and making use of machine learning, we have the whole set of AI services for you. In all of this, I think there's another really big driver for machine learning, and it has to do with education. The fact that it's easier today to learn machine learning as any engineer. You no longer need to be a data scientist. Every engineer can become a machine learning engineer. So, for example, we've launched Amazon Machine Learning University that gives the same training that we give to our Amazon engineers is available for everyone else to use now as well. In all of this, it's important that you get to experiment. You get to play. I think as engineers, we learn most if we can just play with this stuff. So we built a few devices for you that help you play. Yeah, one of them is DeepLens, which was a device we launched 2 years ago at reInvent, the AWS User Conference, that allows you to build machine learning models. So basically, with SageMaker, in 10 minutes, you build your first model, you load it onto the device, and you can start playing with machine learning and vision processing. Last year, in November, we launched DeepRacer, which is a 1/18th scale race car on which you can actually make use of reinforcement learning. Yeah, so this is a learning for which you do not need to label your data, and you can combine short-term with long-term goals. And this has become really successful. If you go out to the expo hall, you see the track over there. You can still compete there this afternoon until 5:30. I suppose you check that out. And we've built a whole league around it. It's extremely popular at each of the AWS summits around the world that we do. The winners of each of those competitions actually are coming to Vegas here in November to compete against each other for the DeepRacer Championship Cup. Not everybody wins a prize, yeah? Although, I love that prize. Yeah. With all of this, we've put machine learning in the hands of every developer to use. Yeah? And if the rest of the world is anything like Amazon, we will see an explosion of machine learning happening in the coming years, driven by the fact that all the heavy lifting around machine learning is taken away from you. So it's really a place now that you have to go build. You have to go do it. We're giving you the tools, yeah? So you should go out and build machine learning models. I'm very fortunate to be able to travel around the world. And in many of these places, I meet young companies. Young companies are doing very interesting things with machine learning. And so we've been building a TV series that's called Now Go Build. And there's two episodes out there already, one with a young company from Jakarta, another one from Singapore. And today we're releasing a new episode with a company from Bergen in Norway. Basically, they're focused on solving the protein problem in the world. That means there's not enough protein to feed future generations. The most effective way of creating protein is actually farming fish. Because 1 kilo of fish feed results in 1 kilo of fish. It's a very effective way. So basically, they have massive pens in the fjords in Bergen. Each of those pens holds 200,000 salmon. And they make use of machine learning to track all those salmon. How fast are they growing? What is their projected weight? What kind of diseases are happening in that pen? So take a look at the trailer for this.
Our planet and our civilizations are changing faster than ever before. This is Now Go Build. Join me as I travel the globe talking to startup founders using technologies to make our world more interesting, accessible and livable. These are the entrepreneurs that are creating the future we will live in.
So check out this episode. It's very interesting to see what young companies are doing with the technology, with the machine learning technology that AWS gives them. So with that, now go build.